Hey everyone, this is Devo, and I'm super excited to share with you a lot of new things that are happening in our lives in this season. We are again going through some major transition, and we're excited to share this with you.
Yeah, it's been a journey, and I'm Donna, by the way. And it's been a journey. We just want to share our story with you, share our heart, and hopefully it blesses you.
Yes, yeah. So a couple years ago, I don't know what you consider a couple, but 2002, 2003, God starts doing what he does. Yeah. He starts parting the heavens and starts speaking into my life. And during this time, I'm transitioning now at that time from my father's church, and something's in my heart. There's more than what I've been experiencing. It's been, you know, at this time, 20 plus years of my life in my dad's church, grew up there. And now God has opened a door for me to attend a church at that time called Time and Destiny, Pastor Gary Zamora. And from the first time I set foot in that church, God just began to prophetically speak to me through Pastor Gary. And almost every word has something to do with youth, youth ministry and worship, or some combination of the two. And God just began to use all of those prophetic words to just grab my heart and bait my heart for something that was more than just a temporary experience. Typically, and my wife, you've seen this before, is that people, when they're working with youth, they work with youth for a season, and then they get old, are tired, are beat up, and they bounce, they leave. Yeah. They don't do youth ministry anymore. And one of the things that really began to hit my heart during that time was that God was speaking a youth ministry into my life that wasn't just seasonal. That it was something that I would do for the rest of my life, reaching youth. The dynamics would change over the years, but I knew that God was calling me to reach the youth. And so we got all these prophetic words. My heart is leaping. I'm excited. I'm stepping into it. And then I get married.
Yeah.
And my wife begins to take this journey with me.
Yeah, I just feel like through every transition, through every season, and we've been married, it'll be 13 years on June 11th. 13 years. Ooh. And seems like through every season of our life, God has just not let us go with this word about youth ministry. I mean, out of the mouth of every pastor that we've ever had, and for my husband, worship, and just that he would do both, that he would do youth ministry. Some seasons youth ministry was much more of a focus. Other seasons worship ministry was much more of a focus. And it just seems like every season, every stage, every place that God takes us, he just reminds us over and over again, this is what you're supposed to do.
Yes, and God never let me just do one or the other. It was always, and I remember telling God, I just was crying out to God, like in desperation almost, like, God, I just want to focus on either worship or youth ministry. And God, over and over and over again, continues to remind me that I have a dual calling to do worship and youth ministry. And
I mean, so, that's played out. It's kind of funny in every single...
I haven't been able to escape it.
Yeah. I mean...
No way.
At one time, he got hired as the youth pastor, and then they found out he could sing. And so then they made him the worship pastor.
And
then he did both.
Yeah.
Another season, we were doing youth ministry.
Same thing, and when I transitioned.
Exactly.
Same
they
thing.
Found out he could sing and do instrumentation and all of that. And so it's always done both, never been able to do one or the other.
I can't escape it. I just can't. Yeah. But and they're two big passions of mine too. There's I really don't want to. It just seems like it. You just don't see people doing like two big passions like that successfully and having them be big deals. And so, and that's always been me, to have one thing that was really good. And what God is calling us to do, worship and youth ministry. And my wife is, which is really cool right now, and is that we're stepping into a season. We'll talk a little bit more about that, but man, my wife is really like locking into youth ministry in a whole new way. And yeah. So I'm super excited about that. And God is always doing these seasons. My wife, we were talking about like we go through, what is it, every 4 or 5 years or something?
Seems like every 4.5, 5 years, God just starts to stir us up. And we don't always know what that means. Mm-hmm. We don't know if that's a new job.
I thought it was the devil at first.
Yeah, he did. Because we didn't want to feel unfaithful, or we didn't want to feel wishy-washy, or we didn't want to feel just like church hoppers or whatever might come with season change. And so it seems like, though, every 4.5 to 5 years, God just starts to stir us. And the problem is that we both feel it. Mm-hmm. So it's not like he feeling something and I'm like, mm-hmm. No, I'm fine. Like, I'm starting to feel the exact same stirring. Yeah. And typically what I've come to recognize now is that just the assignment, you know, if you think of your life in terms of assignments, God just gives us another assignment every 4.5 to 5 years. I don't know why that's his pattern with us, but it seems to be. And hadn't heard anything like that before. I was at a conference and I heard Christine Kane say every 8 years, God gives her a new assignment. And I was like, yes, somebody else has this year
thing. We're not crazy.
We're not crazy, because it seems like every 4.5 to 5 years, mm-hmm. God gives us another assignment, or a focused assignment. Yeah. And that's played out in different ways
And the one thing that's always stayed consistent is youth ministry.
Yeah.
And worship. And then now, you know, my wife, you just wrote a book.
Yeah, I did.
Which is pretty cool, I'm gonna say. I'm the number one fan.
I think that through all of these, even through all the seasons when he was getting this worship and this youth ministry, these words for youth and worship, I didn't really ever get a word in that way. And I just felt like I was along for the ride. I didn't really feel passionate so much about either. I felt passionate about ministry and about helping people. And I knew that I was always going to help people and, you know, help and come alongside my husband in whatever way that I could. But I never quite felt very passionate about, I love to worship myself, but I didn't think I was called to worship ministry. Mm-hmm. And I love the kids, but didn't really feel a strong connection or call to youth ministry. And I just really felt like, okay, I'm along for this ride.
She did it, like, she was amazing at it. And the youth loved her. But I just think, I don't know. I mean, I always told her, you know, she was amazing. She's powerful. She flowed with it. The kids loved her. But I think it was just a spiritual connection.
Yeah. It's kind of about just finding that place and knowing this is what God is asking you to do. And, you know, for me, it wasn't that it was just like, oh, I could do that or I could not do it. It didn't feel like a major, major passion in my life until very recently.
That was pretty crazy. That was pretty crazy. End of 2017, end of October?
Yeah. Well, October. You know what, honestly, before that, even before all of 2017, I think we both started to feel that uncomfortable feeling.
Yeah, and I'm feeling it and I'm fighting it, by the way.
We're fighting it because
I'm knowing, by this time I'm knowing, like, why is this happening I'm thinking, seriously, like, devil, are you trying to get me to be flaky? Unloyal? Like, what's going on? Like,
no.
I love my church, and why am I feeling like you're doing something else? And so in October of 2017, you decide you want to go.
I am on Facebook, and I see this post for The Call. And The Call is a ministry by Lou Engle. And he's in this post, this woman is sharing this prophetic word and about women, and she's saying this is time for women or something like that. And Lou Engle does the call and he says, I'm calling the women.
Lou Engle.
And I'm calling
Love
the
it.
Women.
Yeah.
And I just knew for some reason I'm supposed to be there. Yeah. We see posts for conferences all the time. Yeah. I've seen posts for the call. I love the call, love Lou Engle's ministry. Never felt that drawn to it, but for some reason, that day, I just said, I am supposed to be there. And I just remember looking at the post, looking at the information, seeing when it was gonna be. And I just sat in my living room and I prayed and I said, God, I feel like I'm supposed to go. And if I'm supposed to go, would you just open the door? And I called my husband and I said, I feel like I'm supposed to go to this. It's in October. And I went online. It was in Washington, D.C. I found a flight to Washington, D.C. for like less than $300, something ridiculous that it was.
And that
like,
was the door for me.
You know, I was like, whoa, round trip to DC from California for like less than $300. So I said, I found this ticket. It's like two something. Can I go? And he said, yeah. And I was like, what? You know, really? I can go? And so the money was there. I bought the plane ticket, called my friend. I said, hey, you want to go to DC with me? And she was like, well, actually, I called her husband first and said, hey, can your wife go to DC with me? And he was like, how much is a plane ticket? And I told him, and he was like, okay, yeah, do it. And so I called her and said, hey, I just asked your husband if you could come with me to DC. Let's go to the call. And she was like, yes, let's go. So anyway, October, first weekend in October, I go to the call, go to DC with two of my friends, and we attend this event called The Call. And it was on the Washington Mall. It was raining that day.
That was crazy.
Misting that day.
Wait, hell, don't go. She's about to.
I'm not going to go. Okay.
So, what's crazy about this story is, I don't know if it was a week before you left or
a couple days
whatever.
Before. I don't know.
Anyway, a couple days before she leaves, I get a call from a buddy of mine to go do worship and lead worship for a men's retreat. And I'm like, oh, man, I don't know. My wife is away that same weekend. We got to work out the issue with the kids. You guys who have kids, you guys know how that goes. And so, but man, I felt like this strong peace, like right away, like I was supposed to do it. So without much thinking at all, I was like, I told my wife and I said, I feel like I need to do this. And so we both ended up away, which we've never had that happen. We both are away out of the state. At the same time, so we're both away. I'm in Arizona, she's in DC, and I'm ministering and just there to support and serve, and she's there getting blessed and what have you. And we
hadn't seen each other because when his plane was flying back in, I was already leaving, flying out to DC. So I think he was there like a Wednesday or Thursday, Friday, something like that. Mm-hmm. I left for DC on a Saturday night. So he was flying back in on Saturday. I was flying out on Saturday, something like that.
Yeah.
And so we hadn't seen each other and we weren't gonna see each other or talk to each other really until we both got back. And so I was at DC. I specifically wrote down a question in my phone. I still have the question in my phone because I know that I knew I was going for a reason. Like I needed a word from the Lord. Mm-hmm. And I said, Lord, what am I supposed to do over the next 5 years of my life? What focus am I gonna have? Am I gonna go deeper into therapy? Do you want me to continue social work? Is there some aspect of the ministry that you want me to continue in? I just want to know what my focus is for the next 5 years, just for 5 years. I mean, you can tell me after 5 years, because that's what you seem to be doing. So after 5 years, you can tell me to stay here or do something different. But at least for the next 5 years, I need to know where you want me to focus my life.
Mm. And that's so good, though. Like, I think sometimes we get caught up and just saying, what do you want me to do for the rest of my life? And I think it's a powerful trust in God to just say, God, what do you want me to do for the next day or the next month or the next few years of my life. And it's kind of exciting, actually.
I was very specific. I don't know. I mean, I only think I put down 5 because, again, that's what he's been doing in my life. And if I, you know, I could stay in it for the whatever I'm doing now for the rest of my life. But I just needed to know, can you just give me 5 years? And I'm out there. It's raining. I didn't know you're supposed to bring your own chair. wasn't really sure what that segment was going to look like. But you know what? I honestly didn't care. It was about 8 or 9 hours of it's a conference, but not really. No
you're
one's
worshiping
real preaching.
And praying.
It's exhortation, intercession, and worship. And so you do a session of worship, and then there's people that come up and lead you in intercession for different topics. And then you, someone will come on up and exhort, or we'll talk about what's going on in the nation, and they address different topics. And we prayed for race relations, and we prayed for the Native American population, and we prayed for, President Trump, and we prayed for North Korea. So it's kind of cool to see what's going on in the news right now. And we just cried out to God, and I just cried out to God. Like I didn't know anybody there except for the two friends I brought with me, but it was just me and God alone on that concrete.
And it's all women.
It's mostly women.
So
I mean, I'll say 95%.
Tell them about the women. The was it 2 or 3
well,
older white
so
men?
I'm praying, I'm crying out, probably around, and I stood up probably for the majority of those 8 or 9 hours, probably around hour 7, something like that, just pressing in. I wasn't expecting to receive I didn't know what I was going to expect to receive. I just thought God was going to speak directly to me about what I was supposed to do. I knew he was going to do that. But a girl, her name is Dana, and I remember that because it's so close to my name. She walks up to me and she says, I've been staring at you all day long, basically, and I have a word from the Lord for you.
She was the first one?
She was the first one.
Oh, okay.
There was actually another one. When I was walking by, a girl said something else about deliverance ministry, and she says, you are that person that flows in that.
Wow. And
she
does
just kept
too.
Going. And then this other girl, her name was Dana. She says, I've been staring at you all day. I have a word for you that I feel like I'm supposed to give you. And I said, well, come with it, girl, because I'm ready. You know, I've been standing up for 7 hours and I'm waiting to hear from God. She just said, I see you in schools. She says, I can't tell if it's a junior high or a high school, but I see you preaching to these girls. I see you giving them the word of the Lord. She said, you're gonna bring to them a message of choice, which was crazy because the book that was straining in my heart was about choice. And God had been actually speaking to me about that whole day. She said, you're gonna bring them a message of choice. And I see them going on to do great things. So she says, I see them graduating and throwing their caps in the air. She says, and they're missionaries and they're lawyers and they're doctors and they're great ministers. And she says, your influence is exponential. She says, I see the girls that you mentor are gonna wear banners of significance. She said, you know, they're never gonna have, she just said significance, you're gonna, you know, place so much significance on their life. They're gonna know who they are. They're not gonna need to lean on anything except their significance in Christ. And I'm just weeping and crying. And she's saying, you know, your light, your marriage is gonna be a light and a witness to them. She says, an administrator is gonna give you favor and finances will never be a problem. And so at that moment, I'm just crying and crying and crying. And I'm just like, okay, Lord, if that's what you want me to do, I'll go. Like, I don't care if I never felt passionate about youth before or whatever, none of that mattered. I knew that bore witness with my spirit just so much. And I knew this is my assignment. This is what he wants me to do, at least right now. This is what he's saying.
And it's super exciting because at this point, I'm already in my third year at being in the schools, doing outreaches and these rallies and Christian clubs in the schools. And so she shared that with me and I'm like beaming, you know, like, yes, this is a totally a God thing. God has already putting this together and I'm totally excited. And
yeah, it was kind of crazy. I mean, I just knew, it was just a moment where I said, yes. You know, I don't know if I'm super called to this. I don't know if I'm the coolest person, but if this is what you want me to do, that's what I'm gonna do. And I just knew it was from God. I immediately sat down, wrote down everything I could remember of what she said. Mm-hmm. That's why I kind of have it memorized, because I was literally like, I have to remember every, and I'm sure I'm missing some details. She told me something about different countries. She told me, you know, about if I keep them first, keep the heart of the girls first, that God would expand my ministry. All sorts of things she said to mm-hmm. me.
I mean, you know what I like what you said about cool? And just have to interject, because mm-hmm. that comes up with me all the time. And I remember God sharing with me, and literally the Holy Spirit said, love was always cool.
Yeah.
That's literally God said, like, love is always cool. Like, if you just love them, you don't have to have the coolest clothes on. You don't have to have the skinny jeans on, the ripped jeans on. You don't have to have the lingo. You don't have to do the latest dances. You don't have to have the coolest swag. If you just love them,
right?
God says, I'll send them to you. I'll yeah. give you this generation. And so that's what we're called. That's what God is calling us to do, is to actually right. go into these schools and start loving these kids.
Loving the kids, yeah. At the end of the call, I'm sitting on the ground, just kind of Holy Spirit wasted, I guess. Just cried out, I'm wet because it's raining. I did have an umbrella, but you know that it can only do so much. I'm wet, I've cried, I probably cried 3 buckets of tears. I mean, I just could not cry anymore, could not worship anymore. I am absolutely spent. Sitting on the ground, it's over. I'm just happy for what the Lord spoke to me. And all of a sudden, I see 2 little old men walking back and forth in front of me. And it's strange because it was a call for women. There were a few men here and there, but not very many at all. Mm-hmm. And I see 2 little old men walking back and forth in front of me. Finally, one of them says, oh my gosh, he looks at me. He says, there you are. We've been looking for you. And I'm like, me? You know, like, I don't know who they are. And I'm sitting on the ground. They said, yeah, we've been looking for you. And they just both kneeled down, both of them. I mean, these random men kneeled down, almost like fathers. And, you know, they take my hands and they just said, you know, something to the effect of, because I start crying all over again. And they said, you know, thank you for not giving up in the fight. Many people are going to come to know Jesus through you. And we're so grateful that we got to meet you today.
Wow.
And they said, I can't remember everything because I'm just crying. And I even asked my friend, you know, oh, they said, you know, your calling and your election is sure. And that was such a word to me, because that's something since I was 19 that I've prayed to God. God, make my calling, make my election sure. I want to know it. I want to know exactly what your call is for my life. What is it that you've asked me to do? I want my calling and election to be sure. And he said that. Your calling and your election is sure. And he said, you know, you're a preacher, aren't you? And I said, yeah. He said, yeah, you are. And then he just, both of these little men laid their hands on me and prayed for me. I'm crying, my friend is crying. I don't even know what they prayed, but I felt like they anointed me for something, new season, or just kind of like it's sealing the deal, basically. Like, I'm talking to you. God is saying, I'm talking to you. And it was a powerful moment. I mean, I don't get encounters from the Lord, and I kept saying, why is this happening? You know, like, I don't get these powerful, yeah. amazing encounters from the Lord often.
And what's interesting is that we go years, like, yeah. not having
no
any of this
from the Lord.
We go years, like, not, as a matter yeah. of fact, every time we've had a season shift, God begins to confirm it with dreams. We have people yeah. calling us with dreams about change and transition
yeah.
and that are about to come. And so we're hearing this, and all, you know, these things are starting to register to our spirit. And then, you know, things like this happens, or things like this weekend happens, and like it literally changes. It shakes you up enough
yeah.
to go, okay, you're speaking, God. This is not just me. You're doing something, and I'm paying attention.
Yeah. I mean, I think God was really getting my attention that day. I mean, he sent that girl, and then he sent those 2 little old men who were just random. I mean, I don't even know. I was like, who are
angels.
They? And I'm asking
yeah.
my friend, what did they say? And she's like, I don't know, I was crying. And so looking for them, didn't see them anymore, you know, of course. I mean, they could have been angels. I hope they were, but it was thousands of people out there. They could have just disappeared into the crowd. But the fact that they said they were looking for me and then found me, and I was sitting.
They had been looking for you like from the previous day or all day.
I don't know. I guess all day that day. And I was sitting on the ground. So they were looking for me because in the midst of that whole entire crowd, I'm now sitting down. You can't see me. And they're walking back and forth trying to find me, and they find me sitting on the ground. So I just knew God is speaking. And
so at the same time, again, I'm in Arizona. She's getting crazy breakthroughs from the Lord. And so we had a crazy, amazing time worshiping with the men at this retreat. I'm on my way out. And the speaker for the main speaker for the retreat that weekend just says, "Hey, can I pray with you?" He begins to pray, and then boom, he gets word of the Lord, word of knowledge. At this point, I had not been, I was a youth pastor at my church for, at that point, a little over 4 years. And I had been in my church for 5 years, and so I was youth pastor for 4 years, and then I stepped away to be just fully dedicated to being worship pastor. And so that it had been a year since I had stepped away from being the youth pastor, and that year had some really good things and some really kind of confusing and frustrating moments for me. I'm feeling I have a calling to the youth. And at that point, I'm still in the school. I'm in one school. I was in four high schools at one time, and so I was just in one. And I just, for whatever reason, I just felt like this warfare. I just feel like I just couldn't get the punch and the excitement and the joy of doing youth ministry. And so it's a year has gone by, and I'm really feeling like, and my wife, we were talking about it, I was really feeling dry and feeling like maybe it was over. Maybe I was done with youth ministry. And again, I was gonna just focus on worship and do music. And he hits me with a word, and he didn't know anything about me other than I sang and led worship. And he says, he said a couple of things, but the one thing that stood out the most was that he said, "You have a calling to the youth, that God has called you to minister to this young generation." And I start tearing up and getting, mushy inside. And I just look at my friend and just was like, okay, I walked away going like, okay, this is not an accident.
Right.
My wife is away for the weekend. I'm away for the same weekend. Something is going down. And so at this time, I didn't know that God had already given her these words. And so I texted her going like, "I just got a word." And she texted me back, "So did I." And we both decided, okay, we're going to not talk about this right now. We're going to wait till we get home. And we both got home, and we had a mashup of God's plan and purpose working in our lives for that weekend, and we held it for a few months.
Yeah.
Kind of going,
I think that day that we both came home, I had to have been, I think it was a Monday or Tuesday, something like that, mm-hmm. Or Wednesday. I don't know what day it was, but we were both back at home, and I just remember crying and just going, okay, we're supposed to do this. Like, mm-hmm. God, I mean, how strategic and how gracious of God to shake up our lives in that manner, mm-hmm. and say, no, this is the direction I want you to go. Yeah. I mean, and so dramatically for me, just with those two experiences out there on the mall and on the Washington Mall. And mm-hmm. I think, kind of dramatically for you, just random on a men's retreat, is so strategic, so gracious, mm-hmm. of God to point us in the right direction and tell us exactly what he wants us to do. So we held it.
It was definitely a gift from God, because I just don't think we could make the moves that, because we're talking about transition here. Transitions can be hard, really, really hard. And we went through some pretty challenging transitions in our life. And so we knew, like, okay, this word from the Lord is causing another transition.
Yeah.
We're knowing this, and it's kind of, we're excited, but it's an uneasy feeling.
It's definitely
as
uneasy.
Well, because we don't want to go through transition again. We just didn't want to. I wasn't feeling it. And because relationships are always on the line. People we love, all of those relationships are on the line when you're dealing with transition. And anyone who's ever been through a transition in your church, or maybe move to another church, or you just transition within your church, they can be pretty, pretty challenging.
It's difficult.
And by the way, I think most churches could learn to do transitions better. But we held on to this for a couple months, and then we finally sat down and talked to our pastor, our amazing pastor, Pastor Marco Garcia, and from The Way World Outreach, shout out, whoop, whoop. and yes, that was an old school fist bump. But we talked to Pastor Marco, and we just said, hey, something's stirring, and we don't really know what this is quite yet, and but we're coming to you for some guidance and some wisdom. And so we left there. We had a couple of other meetings. We began to get counsel. The Bible says there's safety in the multitude of counsel. Mm-hmm. And so we begin to seek out counsel from people who have maybe, all of them have been in ministry for years and years and years. They were older than us, really seasoned believers. And we basically went to tell them this story that we just shared with you, and what was on our heart, and what our plan was, and just to make sure we weren't, you know, that
crazy.
We were crazy. You know, because it is crazy what we're doing right now. And we got wisdom, and we've prayed, and then we basically made the decision to step into this full time. And so as of, you know,
I mean, things that happened in the months right after October, the end of the year, the beginning of the year, we know something is stirring.
Yeah.
And lots of things happen. Transition with jobs happen. I mean, it's just relationships, old relationships started to flourish again. I mean, we could just see God's hand of transition.
Oh yeah, God started restoring like some relationships that were kind of estranged for years. All of a sudden, it feels like we haven't missed a beat.
Relationships have come back to be rekindled. New relationships, just kind of like we could feel transition all around. And sometimes that's, you know, like you said, extremely uncomfortable, but exciting at the same time, because you see the hand of God and everything. And, you know, I know for me, it's just, I want to explain everything and make everybody understand. But, you know, sometimes you just go with God. Not everybody's going to understand. And
everybody won't
and
understand.
That's hard. That's difficult.
Hard. It's okay. But
and it's all right.
You have to move forward. And and so we're going to go into the schools. I have taken the biggest step of faith that I've ever taken in a long time. Yeah, actually, it is ever. I did some pretty radical things when I was single with no kids and no wife, and I literally just stepped down as worship pastor at my church. So if you're watching this, you can hear it from the horse's mouth that this was a very, very, very hard decision to make, because everything was good. And we just ended off on the best Easter we've ever had. The relationships that I have with my team, my leaders, just amazing. We're writing songs together. We're putting together some amazing things. We've got some of the people coming in and working on our team that work with, like, big time artists that if I said their name, you would know them, working with major labels, and they're coming in at the church. And now I'm feeling God is saying, step down. I mean, we just had some major upgrades to the church, and I'm like, oh my God, this is amazing what's happening here. What person in their right mind would walk away from this opportunity and this experience? And but I felt God, and I hear God, and I know God, and my safety is in the Lord. I've always put my safety and comfort in the Lord, and the Lord is my refuge, the Lord is my strength, and the Lord is with me. These are all things that begin to just flood my spirit, and a sense of peace, supernatural peace, just came over my heart. And then God confirms it, obviously, with your wife.
He just I mean, it got to the point with God confirming the word that we were supposed to take this step of faith and do this as full time as He will allow us to do, which means a lot. But it got to the point where we knew, almost like this is a Kairos moment. Like, if we do not step out and do this, like, we are in flat out disobedience. And he just confirmed it so many times, so graciously for me, really, you know, for both of us. But, you know, Devo's always ready to just run and jump.
What really did it was, so I started off telling you about the prophetic word that I received back in, what was the year, 2002, 2003, somewhere around there. And so I'm feeling like this change is happening, but I'm like, I need to take a vacation and just clear my heart and clear my mind. So we take a vacation for a week. And since we had that time off, I said, you know what? This is a good time to go see Pastor Gary Zamora again. He's an instrument of God, a prophet used of God to kind of speak to us, you know, back years ago. And so I said, let's go. Maybe there's something there for us. And so we went and we fellowship and we connected, and I got a chance to sing and lead worship over there, and just be a part of some family that I hadn't seen in a long time. And the question we both had was, okay, God, when? We feel like we're supposed to do this.
But when? What's the timing?
And it couldn't get any more clear. He just basically said, Devo, the time is now. And the answer is yes, yes, yes. There's provision for you. And so I look at my wife. I said, what do we do with that word? We obey. And so came off vacation, came back, set up a meeting with my pastor. And I said, the time is now. It's time to do this. And so we're going to go into the schools. We are going to love these kids like they've never been loved before. We're going to love the parents. We're going to love these teachers. We're going to love the administrative staff, the principal there. We're going to love the security guard. We're going to love the janitor. Literally anything, anyone and anything associated with the schools, specifically the one school that we're in right now. We're hoping to do many, many more, but we're going to go and love the people there and love this school in a way that I don't know if it's ever been done. We're going to take Jesus. We're going to take His presence into the schools. And so we've been doing Christian clubs. We have a Christian club called the Alive Club that we do there at Pacific High School in San Bernardino right now. And so we're doing that. We just finished doing school tours. We did several schools where we actually take Christian artists and we go right on the school campus and we sing Christian music, we rap, dance, whatever we can get our hands on. We give them free stuff. We had free pizza, free candy, free nachos. I mean, we're laying it just thick, just loving the kids. And so we did another event where we did something during school, during the lunchtime, and then we did something after school. And we had 100% response. These kids, they usually go home, but they stuck around and came to the concert that we did after school. 100% of those kids, absolutely 100% of them, on their own, without any major prompting, they came and they said, I want to give my life to the Lord. And we led those kids to Jesus. And we're gonna do that again and again and again and again. And we're gonna go back and we're gonna disciple them and we're gonna help them get connected to their local church. We're gonna build the local church, support the local church, and we're gonna love these kids on the campus. And so we're in mentor programs. My wife has a...
Just talked to one administrator. A good friend came into my life in that season from the time of that prophetic word until now, and she actually is an administrator. And I told her that word, and I said, I wonder if you're my administrator. And we knew each other from a distance, but became fast friends. And so her and I even ended up doing a conference together a couple of months ago. But another administrator would like for us to build a mentor program for some of the girls at one of the hardest high schools in San Bernardino, mm-hmm. that's Sierra High School. So this summer I'm going to be working with her to write a curriculum for those girls. And God's already been speaking to my heart about what those girls need to hear. And it's exciting just to bring the love of Jesus in our schools. If you've watched the news at all for any period of time over the past 5 years, you've seen just the devastation that's going on in our high schools. And there's such an onslaught of the enemy against this generation that's rising, and mm-hmm. you know, technology is moving so fast. There really is nothing new under the sun, but man, is there more of
that. It's magnified.
It's magnified. There's these kids are being exposed to things that we know not of.
It's the phones. I kind of want to talk about that for a minute, but they say nothing's new under the sun, but I didn't have a cell phone. So if I, whatever sex thoughts were flooding my mind when I was a teenager and lustful thoughts flooding my mind, all of a sudden that gets magnified. Now you have a phone.
You have access
to it all day.
Right.
When I was back in the day, we used to, have your little fights, arguments, whatever. It doesn't, and then you would go home and you wouldn't see that person until the next school day. Now, it goes to social media that continues. So everything is magnified.
Right.
And it just, the drama and the anger and the hurt of what these kids are experiencing on those high school campuses, it's going home with them. It's sleeping with them. They're up in the middle of the night having these issues. And so there's a lot of work that needs to be done and a lot of love that needs to
be given
out to these kids. And there's a lot of patience. And so we are, like I said, we stepped out in big faith. I stepped off of my job. My wife is along with us. And so our job now is loving these kids.
Yeah.
That's our job.
That's our job.
And so we are actually looking. We have a new website. It's Joyco. We started a ministry called The Joy Company. And the Word of God says, I have no greater truth than to see no greater joy than to see my children walking in the truth. And so that's our joy as well, to see this next generation following the truth, walking in the truth of God's word. And so, like I said, we're in the schools, and the way people are supporting us is they're becoming our partners, our families and our friends. They're partnering with us to help us financially, and they volunteer for us. And so we want to encourage you, if this story has touched your heart, if there's any part of this that says, I remember what it was like to be in high school, I remember the drama, or if you got kids and you know what they're dealing with, and can you imagine if you had a pastor that was on your high school campus almost every day, someone who would go in there and love the kids. And so that's the vision of what we want to do. Part of our vision actually is to employ and hire pastors that will go on high school campuses.
Specifically for the campuses.
I think
one of the things that we've seen, and even that I've discussed with my administration friends, mm-hmm. is that they want pastors on campus. They desperately do.
It's the consistency
or the inconsistency, we'll say, of some. Now, there are some youth pastors out there mm-hmm. that are extremely consistent, and we applaud them for their efforts. But it's the inconsistency that hurts the kids and hurts the Christian club and hurts the campus. And there's inconsistency for all sorts of reasons. I mean, if the pastor has another job or whatever it is. And so it's our heart and our vision to literally employ thousands mm-hmm. of missionaries to these high school campuses, and not just employ, but support and pray for and train and raise up a generation of leaders and pastors who want to touch these high school campuses and be on the high school campuses and, mm-hmm. and focus their energy and their time, you know, on loving these kids and bringing the gospel to the campus.
It's and this, the whole campus,
and the whole campus, the teachers, the administrators, like we said, yeah. the whole campus needs we the wanna, love yeah. of Jesus. And
we want to do a teacher appreciation days where yeah. we're putting together events just to love and appreciate the teachers and so.
The administrators, yeah. the janitors.
I mean, everyone.
It's difficult. You know, if you've ever worked with teenagers at all at any level, you know that it can be challenging. I mean, you know, when you were a teenager, how challenging yeah. you were to yourself.
Think about your kids.
Think about how you were as a teenager and just think that that is multiplied. I mean, one of the biggest things that I've seen is there is such an onslaught of a spirit of suicide on these campuses. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of like this, the kids are going from 0 to 60. They get bullied and they don't want to punch them. They want to kill themselves. I mean, it's mm-hmm. kind of like, mm-hmm. You know, I never even thought those kind of thoughts.
Mm-hmm. Or just stress, not learning how to deal with anxiety.
Yeah.
Not learning how to deal with bullying,
yeah.
The issues that they're having. And we're in San Bernardino. So a lot of these, we're planning on doing as many schools as we possibly can everywhere because all these kids need Jesus. But I mean, the inner city schools need it the most right now. And so these kids that are coming home from low poverty, they don't know. It's amazing. These kids don't know their home address. And I thought that was so weird. Like, how are you in high school and you don't know your home address? Because they move
all the time.
All the time. So yeah. they don't even bother to learn their address. Mm-hmm. And so that's just what we're dealing with these kids in the schools. They're coming from broken homes, inconsistency. And so I really feel God saying, hey, I want you to bring some consistency to the lives of these kids. And so we need your help. We can't do this. We're literally, I felt like God told me to ask you, not to ask you for money necessarily. But he says, tell them to give you a school and give you another school and give you another school. And it's through your giving that you give us another school. It's through your giving financially and through your giving, through your serving and volunteering, you've given us another school to do. You've given us another soul. You've given us another kid whose life is being transformed. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we're asking you to do. I'm asking you to help me take another school and just spread God's love. And so we're gonna start with one school and really focus there. We're still gonna continue to do our tour at all of the school campuses and taking the love of God through our tour, but we're gonna take one school. We're really gonna hone in the love of God there and spend a lot of time in that one school. And so we need you to partner with us. We're looking to get our first 100 partners within these next 30 to 60 days. And we're wanting you to be one of our 100 partners. You can go to our website, go to joyco.info, that's joyco.info, or you can go to thejoycompany.info. It still takes you there. And just go to, poke around and you can see some videos of some of the stuff that we've done, some of the outreaches that we've done, and you kind of get inspired and see that we've been doing the work and already for going on 3 years now, and we're looking to expand the work that you're currently seeing right now. And so we can't do this without you, and we're asking you to really pray and consider making a seed in your heart that says, you know what, I think we can do this, I believe in you. So we love you for listening. If you listen to this whole story, we love you for listening and connecting with us. And I believe that God has partners that are just right for our ministry. Okay. And if that's you, we're more than welcome to join us and support us in that.
Yeah, amen.